Hello YouTube, it's the Frog Queen here, and today I'm bringing you an interview with the talented Simon Roy, who is a comic book artist. Today we're going to talk about his new paperback trade that has been released, and it's actually called Habitat, which was serialized within Brandon Graham's Image magazine called Island. I had first discovered Simon's work when I got hooked on Brandon Graham's series Profit. So let us just dive right in. Before I let you go, I'll let you know that you can access Simon's blog in the description below. And also, Habitat is available on Amazon right now for $12 Canadian, which is a steal, an absolute steal for this book. I suggest you go get a copy. Of course, if you can, please support your local comic book store. But if you do not have access to a local comic store, buy online. It's perfectly all right. Okay, here's the interview.
Are you just waking up?
No, but just like starting the day.
Oh, okay.
I've been up since 10, but I'm still drinking coffee and, you know.
Nice. I just completed my entire work day.
Well done.
Yay! It's a bit choppy, but oh, there it goes. Okay. So it might get a bit choppy sometimes, like I don't know, it's weird. Skype isn't perfect. And like, this is a really good computer. It should be perfect, but it's not.
I think a lot of time it's the internet too. Like, you know, I always have like a trillion tabs open.
Oh yeah, I'm guilty of that as well. I was doing a bunch of like X-Men revisiting or whatever, like of like old X-Men timelines, looking for specific little tiny stories and stuff. So I had like 50 tabs open trying to find exactly what I was looking for. I was like, I can't find this like one mini from somewhere in the 90s that I don't remember.
So you're like deep superhero comic.
No, like, actually.
That is just a thing that happened.
I just like the X-Men. Like when I was a kid, I of course read a lot of X-Men, and Spider-Man. It wasn't. That's like if those aren't the comics I read anymore. Like, I guess after my 20s, I would read mostly like independent graphic novels and stuff. It's just like my first step into comics, I think, was the X-Men. I mean, because when I was like 8 or something, right? So
yeah.
And that would have been the early 90s, I think, on Uncanny X-Men.
Okay, yeah.
So not like the greatest run of ever, but
well, yeah, but it's the stuff that you read at that age that I think like really sticks with you, like. I think I read Transmetropolitan at that age-ish. Or like, maybe like mid-teens. I think, I don't know, like a lot of stuff you consume in your mid-teens I think is really like important for how you, the kind of stuff you consume when you're an adult.
Yeah. What were you reading as a teenager that like impacted your life or that you really remember well?
I know, like, Transmetropolitan was a thing I really loved because it was like a little comic store opened up in a nearby town, and the guy had basically taken a bunch of backstock from the previous comic store that he worked at that had collapsed, and he didn't really get in a lot of new stuff. So whenever I went to the comic store, I was just going through his dollar bins. And so, yeah, lots of Transmetropolitan was there, and then like. I remember picking up Shadowhawk in Youngblood and just being like, what the fuck are these? Like, trying to, like, Shadowhawk just being, like, pretty, even as a teenager, I'm like, I could do better than this, come on.
Well, I remember Youngblood, like, somehow, I remember, like, seeing some issues of those. I don't think I ever bought them, I just remember them, but I, you know, we'd pick them up, flip through them. And I remember one of the comic book stores in my hometown at the time had, like, this really crotchety old man who ran it. And he'd get pissed when you picked it up and flipped through them.
Oh, yeah, it's not a library.
Yeah. So I just remember always being like, I have to do this quickly before I get yelled at, and then slip it back up there on the rack.
But, yeah, totally. Have you ever heard of the Italian guy or Italian cartoonist GP?
Yeah. I've not read anything by him.
That, because he's probably the guy that, like, really freed me up into doing comics, because, like, his stuff is all very, it's all super loose and cartoony, but it's really, his stories are still, like, extremely effective and moving. And at the time, like, I was doing a lot of drawing, but I could never be, like, clean as a mainstream comic, and I'm like, this isn't working for me. And then I saw his stuff, and I was like, oh, I don't need to try and do that. I can just draw loose and use ink wash, and, you know, it doesn't have to look like a computer colored, you know,
and I think,
bag of trash.
Yeah, well, when I got older, like, and, you know, Photoshop, like, I went to school for graphic design and stuff, and Photoshop, you know, was the thing, you know, I suddenly found myself hating and despising comics that were made with a computer, that were colored on a computer. I was just like, fuck, this sucks. And I think that's, like, kind of when I started reading a lot of comics that, you know, were, as you say, loose, I say genuine.
yeah. But, yeah, well, and, like, plus so much computer coloring is just, has been traditionally trashy and still is, like, just, like, lots of gradients, so everybody looks kind of like they're made out of rubber, but in a bad way.
Let's do that. That swatch, or that swatch that does the burst of light, or like the sun glare. I fucking hate sun glares. They're the bane of my existence.
Yeah, like if only one person had used those effects, they might have been interesting. But because like the whole industry was like, oh no, this is how we do this now.
Yeah.
Like.
And Marvel was particularly bad for it. I do remember reading when the X-Men comics, you know, instead of, you know, what I read when I was really young, you know, they started, you know, as I was a late teenager, I guess, is when it started getting really bad with that kind of crap. And then you just, I don't know, there's just the authenticity seemed to disappear. And, you know, you found yourself kind of despising the characters, even though the writing wasn't particularly bad. It was just the artwork was making me sick.
Yeah, totally.
So what are you working on right now?
So I just finished and I've been promoting this guy.
Yay! Is that the trade?
Yeah.
The collected edition from Island?
Yeah, so I've been hustling that, and I went on a little tour to promote it, and I went to Britain for a comic convention to promote it there, but none of my books arrived.
Oh!
So it was a real tragic moment.
That's horrible.
But all in all, yeah, that's kind of been my big thing. And then right now I'm doing freelance stuff for other like non-comic clients, and working on two projects that I'm writing with other artists.
Which so, are the one with Malachi. I always say that because I'm so, like, Nova Scotian.
Oh, yeah, Malachi, eh?
Yeah, I'm like, who the hell is Malachi? I'm like, Malachi, what the hell is wrong with me? It's just because, well, I can see his name, and that's, like, my instinct on how to pronounce it.
Oh, yeah, and it's completely reasonable, but it's wrong, but it's reasonable.
Totally wrong.
But with his, so Matt Sheehan, him and Malachi Ward did Ancestor, and then me and Matt Sheehan are working on, like, a sci-fi story set on Mars.
Yay!
Just slowly, yeah. Basically, it's like an invading army has come from Earth to recolonize Mars, and the people on Mars have, like, been there for, you know, a couple hundred years and are now all, like, biologically networked hive people.
Yeah.
It's just kind of... It's a guy looking for love and coming with the army, over to Mars, and then kind of getting sucked up into a Martian hive and into like non. Instead of basically, it's a story that in part will be like exploring, like, hey, maybe being part of a hive is pretty dope, you know, like. And then the other thing I'm working on is with Artyom Trakhanov, who's done a few. He's a Russian guy who does some Western comics.
Oh, I think I'm Facebook friends with him. I just saw a bunch of, because he did like an awesome Power Rangers.
Yeah.
And like Mask.
Yeah.
He just wrote Mask. Yeah, no. Or
so he's like he did a book called Undertow a couple years ago at Image. He did a book called Turncoat at Boom, I think, with a writer too, and he's like he's very good. And so me and him and colorist Jason Wordy are all kind of working on a project that is another kind of like far future, like Earth is now just like another, it's back into like a previous kind of barbarian age.
Okay.
The story's gonna be about basically like a war chief who's going to put down a slave rebellion, except the slave rebellion has been started by because they dug up like an old NATO cyborg who's now kind of like leading a big slave revolution, and our protagonist has to try and put it down.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So those are the comic things I'm working on, and then I'm not really doing all non-comic work at the moment.
Oh, you have other work besides comic work?
Yeah. So right now I'm doing illustration work on a video game that's kind of like it's like resource management and storytelling, kind of like Oregon Trail, but Bronze Age fantasy.
Oh, cool.
So it's actually a pretty fun project to work on. It's called Six Ages.
Oh, nice. That's cool. I've been actually writing a RPG game for a dude who's producing a video game and wants a story.
That's cool.
Well, it's like slow going because he's still looking for a couple other pieces of the puzzle for it, but yeah. So I guess
a lot of things are slow going though. So
I'm getting that impression when it comes to like creativity and stuff. Everything kind of moves at much slower pace, but
well, especially collaboratively, right? Like if you're by yourself, it's all on you. But if you're collaborating with anybody else, you know. They're not you. They have their own lives. Everyone's very busy trying to survive.
Yeah, totally. Profit. Well,
hell yeah.
I have the first three. I actually have all the singles as well, the floppies, but they're in a box, of course, where floppies go to die, basically. I'm like, what do you do? That's the only my anger about floppies. I love them, and then I'm like, I just have boxes and boxes of these things.
Well, because you don't really want to read them again that much.
No,
that's the thing. Like they're really nice to buy and to hold and to read that first time, but
yeah. And then I turn into a sucker and I buy the trades. After I've already bought the series. And I don't know why I do it. Not with everything, of course, but a lot of my favorite things I'll generally buy twice. It's so stupid.
Well, it's better to read them in trade, but I mean, that is also why everyone is just, it's all trade waiting now.
Yeah. You know? Which is obnoxious and killing the industry. But
also completely reasonable. You know, like,
I don't know. I like binge reading, so I totally get it. I do.
Yeah.
But I guess I wanted to ask you a little bit about your process. Because this up here is yours, the cover.
No.
No, this one's not yours?
That one's Milano Yanni.
Oh, yeah. No, but all this is yours. No, wait, that doesn't work. Oh. Wait a second here. I'm going to find you.
Two, I didn't draw anything in two.
You didn't draw anything in two?
I don't think so.
It credits you as drawing.
Oh. I haven't read the Prophet books in a while.
It's been a while.
Because I know Farrell's in there and Yanni's in there. And
Chapter 2. It says chapter 2.
Maybe I drew like page?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe I'm thinking of the wrong one.
Yeah, because I drew the, like, oh yeah, because that's my cover on that one.
Oh, that one is, okay.
And then the first half of that I drew.
Oh, the first half of the book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, yeah, I wanted to ask you about, like, your process and everything that you, like, how you go about creating your world. Especially with, how do you go about creating it with when it's been written by somebody else?
Prophet was good because it was like there was a lot more room for me to just like it was all very broadly defined. Mm-hmm. So like Brandon just had kind of general ideas and we'd talk them out first and then you know then I could approach from there like the second issue where there's like the big parrot caravan where everything's eating each other's poop. Like that was basically just the idea he had. And I was like, okay, yeah, I can do that. And then I like worked with the colorist and we were like, we looked at episode 1, Phantom Menace, because that's where if you want spherical shield projector stuff, like that's the one really good reference. You know,
that's funny.
Yeah, because that's what the Gungans got. The Gungans got the big circular shield projectors, you know.
Okay, and what do you use pencil and ink? I'm guessing pencil and ink. Am I right?
Actually, I don't know where the holder's over there. But I use the ye olde, like, metal nib.
Ouch.
That you dip into ink.
That's hardcore.
Yeah, it's a little dangerous too because you'll always swab an arm through it. But enough of the. It basically, the big danger with that is like when you get excited and start like inking around the page, jumping from different spots, and then you'll end up putting your arm on something when you're not paying attention.
It's not dry.
Yeah, but usually, but if you're wary, you can avoid that. You know, plus it like. It kind of like carves a furrow into the paper, so it's not like the ink doesn't lift very well, and it's much more. I just like it a lot more as a medium than just like a micron, you know.
Yeah. No. Totally. But less forgiving of a tool, I would assume.
That's true, but I always have a lot of whiteout, so I don't really.
Okay.
I don't mind. I don't fear the whiteout.
So how is it, like, how do you feel about working with a colorist? Because I actually assumed that you colored most of your pages yourself.
I have, like, there's one of the Prophet issues, 32, I wrote and drew and colored it all. But, like, the first three issues, a friend of mine who I was going to school with at the time colored it, Richard Ballerman.
Okay.
And he's a guy who just, like, doesn't really care for comics and works in design now. But at the time, I was like, Richard, you're the best. I need you on board here. And he...
Doesn't care for comics? Works in comics? I'm confused.
Like, not a huge... Not, like, he doesn't hate him. He's just like, eh. Not super engaged with him. But he, yeah, I got him on board. Because I had classes with him, and I was just like, oh, dude, you're so good. Even though he's, like, he's a great illustrator, but he mainly just, like, does design stuff for...
Right, right.
And, like, fancy user interface designs for... Like, I think, like, one job he did was... like, what was it? Basically, like, a touchscreen display on an elevator in a new, like, big tower in Calgary.
Oh, wow.
That was one of the jobs that he worked on.
That's really, really weird.
Yeah.
I would not even assume that is a job.
They're all jobs.
Yeah.
It's a world of jobs out there.
But it's quite a career change, you know, comics versus tech, I guess. Elevator architecture, I don't know.
Well, because that was also, like, that was a summer job for us, too, because I was basically preparing, when we were waiting on Prophet to be approved, I was, like, gearing up to go paint houses that summer.
Okay.
And then Profit got approved, and so it was like, hey, you want to just draw this instead? You want to work on a cool comic and design all the monsters you want instead of painting houses in Calgary?
Oh, you got to design all your monsters, all your aliens and stuff?
Like, oh, yeah. Completely. Basically everything on there I designed. Sometimes, like, specific characters Brandon would give me, like, a preliminary sketch for.
Oh, okay.
But a lot of stuff I just kind of threw together.
Oh, that's cool. I just interviewed Dan Slott a couple days ago, and he was telling me about how he gives his story for Silver Surfer to Mike Alred, and Mike Alred just gets to do whatever he wants and make the aliens look however he wants. So he was saying how interesting it is when he gets back a Silver Surfer comic and he sees what the aliens look like, because he has no idea. He's just like, I don't care. Draw them however you want to draw them.
That's cool.
And Alred's aliens are really great in that series. They're really awesome. So, but yeah, it's going to be nice to have that creative leeway. And I always wonder, like, you know, I mean, I talk to a lot of artists, but some people have very rigid guidelines that they have to follow when they're drawing, you know?
Yeah, I worked on a Halo anthology comic recently.
Oh, wow.
And that was a thing where they were, like, because it was a tie-in for a game that's coming out, or has come out, I don't remember, but it's, basically, they just, like, the licensors were very demanding on how everything had to be perfect, and, the whole project went really slow because I had no direct contact with the licensor, so I'd have to go through, like, the layers of editorial.
Oh.
So, like, I'd send in pencils, and then I'd wait a week for it to... And I'd send it to the editors, and they'd send it to the licensors, and the licensors would look at it, and then eventually send it back, and then they'd send it to me.
Right.
And I just would slowly get more and more notes and maybe get some reference that I had forgotten or not been given. Like, I had to redraw a bunch because I just forgot how to get into the reference file that they provided me. So I drew a bunch of stuff without really looking at it. Then I had to redraw that. And then they started to give me new reference that they hadn't given me that I actually needed, apparently. You know. But, yeah. A lot of hassle. But, you know, Halo's pretty cool. I don't, you know.
It's Halo. I mean, it's a huge franchise, you know.
Yeah. I'm going to try and weasel into another Halo project, but maybe get more control over.
Is that with IDW?
No, with Dark Horse.
Oh, it's Dark Horse. Oh, okay. Yeah. I don't know why I thought... Well, IDW has so many franchises. They publish so many franchise comics, so I kind of get them mixed up. I guess Dark Horse does a lot, too, so...
Yeah, Dark Horse used to have more, but they lost... Like, Star Wars was their big moneymaker, but...
Right, that's right. And that probably hurt them quite a bit, actually.
I think so, because that's, like, a guaranteed market.
Yeah, you know? There's always going to be Star Wars fans who are going to read them. I've never read Star Wars comics, and I am a huge Star Wars fan. People think this is crazy, but I honestly... It's weird to me to read comics based on Star Wars. I don't know, it's weird.
Well, and it's like, I know there are different approaches now, too, because, like, when I was a kid, I was into the extended universe stuff. Like, I read a few Boba Fett comics, and I read some novels. And, like, Dark Horse, when they were doing Star Wars stuff, it was all, like, expanded universe stuff. But now that it's Marvel, it's like, through the Marvel Disney thing, it's all, like, directly tied into a big unified marketing scheme. And instead of expanding the universe, it's just like, let's just milk all these characters even more, you know, let's squeeze every drop out of them.
Well, that's why every single character has his own series now.
Yeah,
with Marvel.
Yeah,
and why
it's not like a cool adventure with like some new guy that you haven't seen before.
Yeah, so there's like,
'cause you might not buy that.
Yeah, exactly. And they've pretty much completely ignored, I think, episodes 1, 2, 3, which I don't blame them, but...
But still.
Yeah, but it's part of the extent... It's part of the universe, right? You know?
Yeah, it's part of the property they bought.
Yeah, but I mean... I totally get it. They flopped, so everybody kind of hates them, and, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway. But I did want to ask you about what you prefer to read. I always ask everybody what they're reading now, what, you know, what kind of stuff you like to read personally. When, and sometimes I get those people who are like, I don't read comics. I make them, but I don't read them.
I am often that person.
Oh, no.
I'm trying to remember because I just got some comics, but they're... Oh, wait, no, never mind. I can... Give me a second. I just want to look.
That's okay. I'm going to blow my nose.
I got a few comics that I liked recently, but I'm not, like... I don't have the relationship with comics now where I'm like, oh, my God, this... I just got to keep coming back to this.
Yeah.
You know, like... I do with, like, prose books, but not usually, not often comics, I guess. But here, I'm gonna look real quick.
No worries. I'll be right back, too. I just gotta grab something. Lord. I'm thirsty.
I guess it is like 4 o'clock, right?
Yeah.
Where you are.
Yeah. No, it's like it's almost five, so.
Okay, that's
legit. But basically, yeah, I get off work, and I do these interviews are always super informal, because I hate the super overly formal, overly broken down, like, not friendly kind of interviews that you usually see.
Yeah.
I hate that shit, so I just do them really informal. If there's some stuff I need to cut out, I'll cut it out, I'll edit it, because I edit video for a living, it's not a big deal. And then I'm just like, there, see, that was more fun. If it's not fun, I don't want to do it. I work all day.
All right, I'll show you some of the books. So, Mezzelith.
I've never seen this before.
It's British.
Okay.
I ordered the first book. Let me see if I can find a good page. It's basically like Mesolithic... like, just past the end of the Ice Age of Britain.
Okay.
And it's drawn really pretty.
Ah. That's awesome.
So it's like, I've done a caveman comic for Dark Horse, and I like seeing the competition, and this is, like, pretty good competition.
Is that what you, that's how you view other artists? They're just competition?
If they're specifically doing like the genre niches that I'm interested in doing,
right?
Then I think of them and I'm like, directly compare them to the stuff I'm working on.
Okay.
So Mezzelith, I'm like, competitor, but you know, I'm safe. This is a really dope book. Kill 6 billion demons.
I have that on my Amazon list. I haven't read it yet, but it's on my wish list.
Yeah, it's very intense and ambitious, and it's a really
in a good epic, or bad like, way.
In a good way.
Okay.
It's really Tom Parkinson Morgan. I actually saw him when I was in Portland this past month, and he's really good, and he's building a very giant world in this book. Which I really appreciate.
Nice. Because it's not very old, right? That's a fairly new book.
Yeah, and he's been doing the webcomic for a couple years, I believe.
Yeah, okay.
So, he's got a lot more where that came from. Plus, it's called Kill 6 Billion Demons, which implies a lot of stuff.
Yeah, and I mean, I have to admit the title and the cover popped up as a suggestion for me when I was Amazon purchasing, and it popped up and I was like, ooh, what's that? And I'm like, add to wish list.
I'm going to see if I can show you. There's a lot of really great spreads. I'm going to find my favorite one. There's one where basically it's like, part of the story is that heaven, you can't really see. You can't really see that well, but it's like a very complicated diagram of a big, like, walking city.
Oh, sweet. That's pretty cool. Hell 71.
So basically, like, heaven got penetrated by a mortal man and a group of mortal people who became evil gods, and now heaven is like a disgusting ruin. It's complicated, but it's good.
Okay. All right.
This is a book that I read in the summer that I liked a lot.
I haven't read it, but I've seen it around.
Good. Yeah. It's really good. It's like weirdly subtle and very authentic.
Cool.
It's all like, well, it's like, you know, a bunch of teenage, it's really like appealingly drawn teenage kid stuff.
Okay.
But there's a weird thing where it's like none of the parents are around, and you slowly start to wonder more and more, like, where are all the parents? and you find out by the end, kind of indirectly, which is really good. And then also, so then the other ones, Ancestor, which is another island thing, which everyone should read and buy.
Everyone should.
It's a really nice book too, like as an object. Rumble, I've been liking a lot.
Oh, too. I love Rumble. Oh, yours is signed. I'm so jealous.
Yeah. And then I did a pinup for the latest trade, so I'm just like waiting on my comp of the new trade to come in.
Oh, I'm doing an interview with John Arcudi, next week, I think.
Oh, sweet!
Yeah, in a week or two. I've interviewed him before, just not through video, because before Rumble came out, I started freaking out, and I got, like, my advanced copies, and I was like, I need to talk to them about this now, and I got to both of them, so... Yeah,
Arcudi's nice. Arcudi's a really sweet dude.
Yeah. And he's got a new title launching shortly, so
yeah, which also looks pretty intense.
Yeah, the preview art that Image, I think it was Image released, was like, oh my god, I was like, oh, this looks intense. So
yeah, and then I also got this, a Malachi Ward book.
Nice,
which is good. Him doing, it's something that I want to try again too in the next little while. Is this is a, basically like a collection of a bunch of his short stories. And I feel like it's a really interesting format, seeing a bunch of short stories, and it's you don't see it often enough in comics.
No.
Like.
Yeah.
This is also a super, super beautiful book.
One of my favorites. Oh my god.
I still haven't fully read it. I just keep looking at it.
It's amazing.
Like, and just she's all amazing. The design is so good.
She's an amazing artist. Like, I follow her on Facebook and everything, and like the stuff that she's working on now, she posts stuff every now and then, and you're just like, holy crap. Like,
yeah, that was basically like a guy that, in the studio that I work out and brought his copy by, and I was just like sucked in for half an hour, and I didn't even read any of it. I was just like slowly flipping through and looking at all the artwork. And it's super,
super
beautiful.
I think it was originally in Italian. I can't remember. It's not originally published in English. Humanoids has republished it. There's another really good one too that Humanoids just did that is very little known, whenever I think of that book, the Swords of Glass, I always think of this one, which is The Legend of the Sacred Swords, or The Scarlet Sword. And that's another humanoid. It's equally beautiful in its own way, but it's just like those two books always in my head as some of like the most beautiful humanoids books, modern humanoids books, right? Because of course they're publishing Mobius and all those kind of older books as well, but which are beautiful. But anyway,
what's the book called again?
The Legend of the Scarlet Swords. And there's a sequel to it too, or it's a prequel actually.
Called Legend of the Scarlet Blades.
Blades, that's what it is. Yeah, and then there's a prequel I think called Izuna. And they're just cool. Gorgeous, like gorgeous fucking books.
That's cool. Oh, nice. Yeah, Humanoids is a cool publisher.
I'm a horrible Humanoids junkie, unfortunately. Like, not unfortunately for me, because some of their books can be expensive to get here in Nova Scotia. I really love them. I've been covering their books since I started doing reviews and stuff. Yeah. And they always have such good content. Even like there's the obvious big sellers for them, like the Jodorowsky books and stuff. But like, they take on these new artists and writers all the time, and like you didn't think. I don't know. It's just weird. Like, I know if I wasn't into the Humanoids label, I would never know about those books. But yeah, I'm wrapped up in Humanoids, so.
There's a really weird, I don't know, like, North American comics just feels very weird and insular. You know, like, it's hard. It's very easy, it seems, for people to just read, like, Big Two stuff and then some Image titles. Right. And not really get any other of those sweet flavors. You know, there's so much better stuff than that, too.
Oh, yeah. And as much as I do still love a few of the Big Two titles, they are so few in compared to what they actually put out. There's, like, hardly anything I want to read compared to all the titles that they actually, all the comics they actually publish. It's like, I want to read maybe two of those titles this year. Maybe. You know?
Well, that's the same for me with, like, I mean, they are my bosses, so I probably shouldn't, but, like, a lot of Image stuff, like, really doesn't appeal to me. Like, I don't know, most comics don't appeal to me when I'm just, like, looking at the stands.
Right.
You know? Like, most monthly comics, I know that there's good stuff there, but I just, like, it's hard for me to give a shit and like, actually start to look through stuff. Whereas, like, if you go over to, like, the box full of European trades, I'll be like, oh, there's probably something here that I'll like.
Yeah.
You know, it'll cost me $20, but, you know, it'll be a nicer thing and I'll enjoy it for a while.
So, am I wrong to think that you also, like Brandon Graham, are influenced by, like, Mobius and those kinds of European artists similar to that vein? Or would I be, am I in error saying that?
No, well, I didn't know about Mobius till I was, like, in my early 20s. So, it wasn't, like, formative, but since seeing Mobius, I've been, like, very inspired to, just, like, draw everything. That's the thing that he does, that he just, like, he doesn't, he's kind of on the opposite end of Mignola. Like, Mignola is kind of the, so perfectly designy that he, like, he doesn't really have to draw that much because he's, like, using shapes and darkness to really get out of boring detail that he clearly doesn't want to do. But he did. But all the pages are so beautifully designed that, like, you can't help but be pulled in. But then Mobius is, like, the opposite end where he takes, like, zero shortcuts and draws everything in perfect perspective. And, like, every panel convinces you that it's, like, a real space.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, that's awesome. Yeah. That's really nice. I think that's the thing that I really notice in shitty North American comics is just, like, being unconvinced of the space. Yeah. Where you're just, like, it's just, like, yeah, you can draw these, like, three figures that you change the hairstyles of, you know, and put different clothes on. but I'm never convinced that they're in a real space.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree that it's something hollow there, you know?
Yeah.
So then who are your big inspirations?
As a kid, like, Bill Watterson was a huge one.
What did he do?
The Calvin and Hobbes guy.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I think he lives here on the West Coast, Robert Bateman, who's like a photorealistic wildlife painter.
Yeah, I know that because my mother, because of my mom.
Well, because he's like, everyone loves his paintings because they're basically just like beautiful photos. Yeah. Trying to think. And like, I read a lot, like I liked Tintin, but like I loved Asterix when I was a kid. So
Asterix Obelix? Yeah.
I think those are the guys that I was most into as a kid. And then as I got older, like, I looked at a variety of things, but I think that's like the bedrock, you know?
That's interesting though, because like your art totally speaks so independently of those. I mean, I can see a little bit of the Calvin and Hobbes in your penciling and what your inking. I should say inking, since you're inking, not penciling, but...
I do both.
You are penciling, then inking? Yeah, okay. I was going to say, you're not taking that big of a risk. Constantly, all the time. But yeah, I guess I could see, like, Calvin and Hobbes. So that's interesting. Yeah.
Well, because think of, like, the later Calvin and Hobbes, especially where he... Like, for the Sunday strips where he'd just, like, do a beautiful spaceman spiff adventure, or... Basically, like, by that point, by the end of the strip, he was just, like, constantly showing you how well he could draw in really nice ways.
Yeah.
Yeah. And as a kid, too, like, he did dinosaurs amazingly. He did jet fighters amazingly. He combined the two occasionally. Like, Bill Watterson is kind of... He's kind of the best, you know?
Nice. Okay, all right. I have to ask you my big final question that I ask everybody, which is if you could work with anybody ever, who would you really want to work with? Which also can insult other people that you currently work with. I'm just joking.
No.
I'm joking.
Yeah, I don't know if I have an answer to that. Like, I'm really excited to be working with Matt Sheehan. Because, like, we've been talking about this story idea for years now, and it's been really cool. Like, I talked to him initially because I was thinking about drawing the story, but I couldn't figure out how it should look. And I was like, this isn't working when I'm doing it. And then I brought the ideas over to Matt, and he started to develop them, and they, like... They all started to look really cool and take on a life of their own. So, I mean, I am lucky to be working with Matt Sheehan and to have gotten to work with Brandon Graham, too. But in terms of, like, a dream collaborator, I don't think I really have one.
Okay. Now that's fair.
Yeah. I just want to convince people to pay me to... draw and write my own shit. That's the ideal path, but that's also a more difficult one.
But you're living it. So when does Habitat Trade come out? Because it's not out yet, is it?
It is.
When did it hit the stands?
End of October.
What? Okay.
Yeah.
I don't remember getting the image announcement, which I should have gotten. But anyway, I read it in Island, so.
Well, there's a couple added pages.
Really?
And a sketchbook section. Okay. So you should probably buy it in trade as well.
Well, I've done it here, so.
You've already started.
I know, it's a mess. I have no shelf space at all. Like, I need new shelves. It's bad.
Oh, yeah. I have piles of books currently. I'm not going to turn around the computer and show you, but it's bad.
Yeah,
it's
bad. I can only imagine. Next to the fork in the fork?
Oh, sorry, you missed out this. There's two spoons too.
Okay, nice. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining me today and doing my, you know, my little YouTube show. Do you have a website? I know you have a blog that you update.
Yeah, basically, like I have the blog that I update sometimes. I have Tumblr, which I fool around on, and I have Twitter, which I'm sometimes on too. Okay. So like, I don't have like a nice single website, but. There's garbage online.
Well, I will put all those links in the description below the video so that everybody can check you out and follow you and stalk you online.
That sounds good. Well, and I'll try and represent the DeviantArt one, too, because there's lots of old, weird dinosaur drawings on there.
Oh, sweet.
So, yeah. You want to look at speculative dinosaur designs?
I do, actually.
I'll dig it up. But yeah, nice to chat with you, Amy.
Okay, well, thank you so much. Oh, and one last question, sorry. Are you doing any cons in the next year that we should know about?
Definitely Emerald City, TCAF, and VanCAF. Okay. Those are for sure the ones I'm
doing. I'm going to try and go to TCAF, so maybe I'll see you there.
Yeah, it'll be nice.
Cool. All right, take care.
Okay, you too.
Thanks.
Bye.